Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome once again ABC News correspondent John Donvan.
Hello again, everyone. I hope you are enjoying this conference as much as I am as we head down the home stretch this morning. And I want to ask our next panelists to take their seats and set up, which will take a minute or so. And while that's happening, the organizers have asked me if I would share a sort of journalist insider story with you. And the reality is that I had a lot of them. After 30 years of covering the news, there were the stories that I put on the news, which were the news, and then there were the kind of behind-the-scenes stories and the personal experiences, which were the things I would tell my family about or my friends over a bottle of wine. So I'm going to, and some of them would get kind of surreal. So here's one of the surreal ones. I covered the White House. I was working for ABC News as the White House correspondent during the Bill Clinton administration in 1997 and some of 1998. And every now and then you draw the straw to be one of the few journalists who travels with the president on Air Force One. I probably did that 6 or 7 times. And on one night we had been with President Clinton out west. He had been inspecting, I think, the results of some flood damage. And it was a long flight back. And it was that time of night coming back where they dim the cabin. And just like in a commercial aircraft, they put a movie up on the screen so that everybody could see. And a new movie had just come out, and it was called Air Force One. And so it was surreal, first of all, to be traveling on Air Force One, to be watching a movie on the little screens about Air Force One, in which they made an exact replica of the actual airplane that I was sitting in. But the really surreal thing is that the story of the film of Air Force One is that gradually Air Force One is taken over by terrorists, and gradually Air Force One is destroyed in the air. And so I had the six, and the other thing that happens is that the president, played by Harrison Ford, escapes Air Force One in the president's special escape pod, which is built into the bottom of the airplane in the movie. And so by the time this thing is unrolling, and again, it's late at night and the lights are dimmed, and I look out the window at the country beneath just at the same moment that a passenger on the plane in the movie is looking out. It looked like exactly the same window underneath, and then the plane is starting to go down, and I'm not. There was this crazy confusion of, this jarring confusion of fiction versus reality. The good thing is the movie ends. There is no escape pod in Air Force One, and I learned that President Clinton was up front and safe and sound. So that was sort of relaxing for me, but it's a story that I love telling, especially nowadays, because it seems that we may be in a period in terms of the White House when this fact and fiction line keeps going like that. So I share that with you as one of the many privileges of being a journalist, is you get these really, really distinctly different kinds of experiences behind the scene that never really rise to the level of making the news, but now it's a story you can take with you. And I want to join our panelists now to begin the conversation. So we have a panel of people who are leaders in the business, and I'll begin by introducing them. To my immediate left is Andy Boyer. He is president and CEO of Teva Generics North America. He came to Teva from Actavis's US Generics division, where he was serving as vice president of generic sales and marketing. Before that, Andy held a variety of senior management posts at Watson, Lederle, and Bayer Laboratories. To his left is Alok Sonig, who is executive vice president of global head of the North American region for Dr. Reddy's Laboratories. He joined that firm in June of 2012 and runs both the India region in addition to global business development. Prior to that, he was 15 years at Bristol Myers Squibb, where he held several leadership positions in general management and country leadership, and as a vice president for strategy. He holds a bachelor's of engineering from Punjab Engineering College in India, a master's in business administration from AU in Washington. To his left is Craig Wheeler, president and,
we may have to switch a little.
Yeah, everything's out of order, okay. Okay, so to his left is, but you were able to follow that, sure, yeah. Pretty smart crowd. Yeah, do the wave, that helps me a lot. So I'm gonna go into Craig Wheeler. He's president and CEO of Momenta Pharmaceutical. And in May of 2012, the Boston Globe named Momenta the number one company in their annual Globe 100 survey of top performing companies. Craig has also served as chairman of the board for this association and chairman of the board of Avenir Pharmaceuticals. And finally, that leaves Vinita Gupta, who is chief executive officer, Lupin Limited. And previously, she was CEO of Lupin Pharmaceuticals. That's the US subsidiary. And she is director on the board and a director on the board of Lupin's Japanese subsidiary. She holds a bachelor's degree in pharmacy from the University of Mumbai and an MBA from Northwestern University's Kellogg Graduate School of Management. And what I want to do is sort of bring home through you the themes that have been laid out over the last 3 days, beginning with what Chip Davis said in his remarks yesterday, which was that the confusion and almost the identity challenge that faces the generic industry vis-a-vis the brand industry, perceptions on the part of the public, on the part of politicians, he said ultimately comes down to you, the participants in this industry, to get your message out. And his implication, strong implication, was that the industry has not been doing very well at that, hence the name change, the beginning of a shift in direction with that. But let me go to you first, Andy, on that. Do you cop to that analysis but as a member of the industry, that the industry has been slow to care that much about public perception and that that's been a problem and that it needs to be addressed?
So I would say that our share of voice has not as been as loud as it needs to be. So changing a name is only part of the process. What we really need to do is change our image and change our voice within the marketplace and within government and every place else. So if we want to talk about access to medications, you know, how are we doing that? Showing everybody around us what we're doing to bring that home. Talking about lowering the price of medications and improving the quality of lives of patients around the world. We have not done a great job individually as companies.
How come?
Or as an, I think that everybody's busy. Mm-hmm. Everybody is looking at their own organization and trying to do what's right, you know, there. And to be fair, we haven't had the budget that Big Pharma has had, and we've let them tell our story for us. And I think we've gotten to the point now, and I think there was great discussions over the last couple of days, and Chip, you know, kudos to Chip and the entire team. They've really brought the message home that we need to get out there as individual companies, as individuals within those companies, and more than just the CEOs, but the entire organization to get behind the message and what we present to the marketplace and how we can create value.
And Andy, just a little bit of the backstory on where you're coming from. You're relatively new with Teva.
Relatively new with Teva, but I'm coming from the activist organization, which I've been a part of for probably 18 years or so now. Yeah. So I'm not new to the industry per se.
I'm just curious, and maybe we can learn from this part of your experience. It's an Israeli-based company. I happen to be a Catholic boy married to an Israeli physician. That can be a culture shock. I'm curious, and I'm only half serious, but I'm curious for you working with an Israeli company, what have you learned about management style, priorities, et cetera?
Well, I'd love to say that I've only been there 5 months now, but what I'd love to say is I had a full head of hair and it wasn't gray at all, you know, about 5 months ago, but that's really, really not accurate. What I would say is it is a very, very direct culture. That's good, because
that's... Well, what do you mean by direct?
Well, direct, you've got something to say, you come out and say it. There's no personal agenda. You don't have to be concerned about, you know, not saying what's on your mind. That's an ability for us to take and move forward when things aren't right. And as you're bringing two organizations together, the one thing that Teva always said was, we want to take the best of the best. and the best of the best processes and systems. And if you've got an organization that's willing to speak up and recognize that this is not the way we've always done it, that directness really helps.
Well, and in observing that directness, are you also observing that the rest of the industry has been lacking in that, has been a little bit too timid?
Well, I can't speak to everybody in the industry, but I think you have different cultures at different companies. You know, Activist was a different culture than Teva is. Activist, prior to the acquisition of Allergan and some of the other brand components, was a different culture. So they evolve over time. I think it's those organizations that evolve, adapt, and more importantly, recognize there's a better way to do it going forward, yeah. Much the same as the association is looking at. Those are the ones that will be most successful in the future.
Vinita, I want to have you also address the question of share of voice, but first let's learn a little bit more about you as well. You and your brother now are principals in a company that your dad started from pretty much nothing and has made a power. We were chatting before, and you said that now that you've taken leadership in the position in the company, you feel that one of your main roles is to not mess it up. So how do you go about it?
Well, with a lot of passion and dedication. I mean, before we, both me and my brother, took the leadership role, that was 4 years ago, me as CEO, him as managing director. We worked for long years in evolving our organization from an Indian company with a business that was primarily India-based to a global organization, which today, you know, if you look at Lupin, 10 years ago, it was 25% outside of India, 75% in India. Today, 75% of our business is outside of India. So we navigated the strategy across the globe, setting up our operation in the US, getting into Japan, getting into Europe, South Africa, Latin America, what have you. But you know, the focus is very clear to take the platform that our father, our chairman, had built a very strong foundation for the organization in India, serving a cause that was very, very important, high national priority. He started the company based on the focus on tuberculosis and then got into general anti-infectives. We took the general anti-infectives as a platform to get global. You know?
And in going global, was that, you know, between parent founder and children's successors. Is that a difficult conversation? Did you have to persuade your father about it's time to try something new? Or was it more, I'm bringing you in because I need something new to happen?
Well, my father's an entrepreneur, and I'm an entrepreneur. So it was as much as we always debated, when we saw an opportunity, we got behind it.
He didn't do what you did. And
he started from scratch. He started the company with $250.
Wow, really?
Yeah, $250, borrowed from my mom. And built it up from scratch.
This is a good investment by your mom.
He was a very astute venture capitalist.
Yeah.
But no, so it was a different time and a different scale. You know, he really built the company in India when the government was offering incentives for Indian entrepreneurs to set up manufacturing in India for the Indian market, because the Indian market up to then was really served by multinationals that were dabbling in the market. They were not there for the cause.
Right.
So his goal was to really establish Lupin for an area of high national priority. For myself, who joined first, you know, after I finished my pharmacy and got my MBA. I worked for a very short time for Big Pharma, and I knew very quickly that was not for me.
Why?
Just the bureaucracy, the pace at which they operate, and I was actually in a pretty entrepreneurial part of Big Pharma, but that was not still the kind of pace that agreed with me. You know, I had seen a company built by my father as well as the leadership teams so rapidly, you know, seizing opportunities that came along the way to differentiate the organization. That was the kind of environment that I wanted to be part of. So I wanted to take the platform, you know, that he had built and take it to the next level.
And to what Chip Davis was talking about, the failure of the generic part of the sector to tell its own story, Do you agree with that diagnosis?
Yeah, absolutely. I do agree that, and with what Andy just said, that we lack the share of voice that Big Pharma has. We don't have the kind of resources.
Lack of resources.
Okay. Lack of resources. We get broad brushed with Big Pharma all the time, which is a shame because our industry does so much, to address healthcare expenditure. We are the solution to drug cost and drug spend. Mm-hmm. The HHS recognizes that. They did a study last year that concluded that the generic industry is truly competitive and is the solution. But I think that we have an opportunity now with the new administration to really get behind this and speak both as an industry association with our new branding, as well as individual companies to make the point that we really do a lot to address the healthcare, the spend challenges within the country.
Okay, and for this opening, I'm just going in the order in which you're seated. So Alok, let's bring it to you. Sure. Tell us a little bit about your story of getting into the industry.
So I was born and raised in India. I came to the US, it was about 27 years ago for my MBA, and went through that, was in Washington, DC, got exposed to management consulting earlier on, and one of my clients was GlaxoSmithKline. So I was then suddenly launching the first drug in HIV for GSK, and just found this very interesting that there wasn't just any kind of business or marketing thinking. You had the R&D labs and you got the sales teams, and there was nothing in the middle, right? Mm-hmm. So I just saw that as a kind of white space and embraced it, and ended up after a few years in consulting. So, the other areas were high-tech consulting with my kind of background, and worked with mobile and Microsoft and other companies on some launches, but then chose pharma for kind of that wow factor of just being customer-centric and patient-centric and be able to understand what their needs are and essentially just be able to make products that customers wanted, which was at that time a novel idea.
Did you say that you had worked for Microsoft?
I consulted, right, in my consulting firm. So
I just want to understand that distinction, because Microsoft is certainly customer-centric, and certainly that period had a wow factor. So what else was it about pharma that grabbed?
So pharma was just so behind, you got to understand this from a vantage point of just fresh MBA grad with some consulting years under his belt. So I thought this was just, there's a lot to be done here from a customer-centric thinking, marketing, mindset, that there's a lot of white space here. And, Microsoft was ahead. So were some of the other companies. But, I also wanted to stay on the East Coast. So that was the other reason. So.
That works out.
Yeah.
But if I'm understanding what you're saying, you were with pharma. You were not with the generic.
No, so I was with large pharma, so I kind of, some of the comments that Vinita was making resonate with me, so, they kind of work at a certain pace, and you've got to create your own pace and opportunities in companies that sometimes get managed like countries, right? So I learned a lot, though, from Big Pharma, the methodical kind of aspect of R&D and capital allocation, where do you see future bets, and how do you kind of focus more deeply on kind of spiky growth areas and make it your own, and eventually commercialize it and build a scale globally. So, and that I think is of tremendous value in where I find myself today in a generic company that similar to what Lupin's done. Started out in the early 80s, thanks to our founder, Dr. Anji Reddy, and globally spread out to more than 40, 50 countries, and fairly similar story. So now I'm able to, apply those skills.
But
in this.
When you made the switch to the generic sector of the business, did you have this sense of, as your colleagues here have talked about, sort of a lack of resources suddenly hitting you and telling your story?
Absolutely. So I completely agree with what Andy and Vinita said, so, and what Chip said yesterday. So we just didn't have the messaging right, and just given the resources the other side has, you just get outshouted and you get painted with the same brush. I mean, we are 89% of the prescriptions are generic prescriptions in the U.S., mm-hmm. and we only take about 25% of the costs. So if you're part of the solution, if I flip it, you know, 11% of the prescriptions are large pharma, which take up 75% of the cost, just to put it in perspective, right? So unit basis, I was looking at data for 2016, for the first time in many years, the generic cost per unit actually came down. We declined by 1.5% versus large pharma growing at 11%, you know, losing volume. So the
price increased. Why is that story not out?
You know, we will drive that change, you know, starting with, you know, I know it's symbolism, but we really stand behind what we mean. It's the Association for Accessible Medicines, and we are about...
Does that phrase flow comfortably?
It's not very comfortable, you know, I think it comes from here, but we'll get used to it. So, yeah, I think the story will come out eventually, and, you know, it'll resonate, and we'll be out there, hopefully, and you'll be the judge.
Okay, and Craig, let's tell you, now you're in the case of Momenta, that there wasn't a $250 loan from anyone's spouse, but this was one of those, it came out of, worked on at MIT, am I correct?
The founder yeah, I was gonna say, you know, there's some similarities here in terms of, you know, our founder was from India, he was in the faculty at MIT. The difference is he actually went to venture capitalists as opposed to his mom to get the money. So. So it was a platform out of MIT, but it was kind of one of these crazy ideas of trying to start a generics company from scratch, you know, in, you know, 15 years ago, which not a lot of people were doing at that time and trying to get into it. But we saw the opportunity to go after drugs that were very complex using these tools that we actually were able to bring into the company from MIT that other people had not previously been able to make generic. And it gave us both an opportunity, but also a way to make a real impact in terms of, you know, getting more cost-effective drugs to patients.
And this, again, to the Chip, what I'm calling the Chip Davis point, the story just not getting out there. Why has it not?
Well, you know, I've been, you know, part of trying to be a voice for this industry for quite
long
a while
time.
Now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not that easy to tell our story, right? And, you know, it's easy to cast it in, you know, the David and Goliath of you know, they're putting $100 million into, you know, this year into lobbying and advertising and pharma, right? Which is a huge amount of money. You know, it's the profit that will be reaped out of many, 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 many generic products, right? That's being paid in just, so it's easy to get caught in that. But there are other things that are fundamental about who we are and where we've come from that I think it make our story a little harder. We're not, when you go to your pharmacy and get a generic, you don't necessarily know which one of the products you're getting, so you're not becoming as brand loyal as you would in it. I think the ability to actually get out and talk, because we don't have the large commercial infrastructures that the pharmaceutical companies have, mm-hmm. puts us in a very different position. So I've always looked at it through the lens as we need to magnify our voice, right? So I think this rebranding is good, but we are a big part of the solution in terms of healthcare costs, and therefore we should have a lot of allies in, you know, patients, in physician groups, et cetera, that we need to get on our page of singing, you know, out of the hymnal that we're trying to create here, is that we are reducing costs as an industry, not increasing costs. And I think we need to magnify our voice in different ways because we just don't have the capital to put into the messaging.
Well, I mean, far in terms of the capital, pharma does put an enormous amount into messaging for itself. And as you have pointed out, and it's been pointed out to your detriment, because they end up, in a sense, telling your story instead of you telling your story. But is the solution for generic firms which have been shy about spending big amounts of money on marketing to start doing that?
Well, we don't have the margins that the branded companies have per se, but, you know, I think it's just the story. You know, the cost of healthcare is rising every single year, and we're the only part of the healthcare system probably that is lowering costs every single year. And we have 300-400 products as Teva today. Every year, our price, we have price deflation.
Well, I know that, and so, everybody here knows that, but my question really is should there be a shift in allocation of capital to put a lot of money behind telling the story, or do you just not have it?
I think you're seeing it. I think, you know, with the dues restructuring, we're putting more money into the association. I think we're all collectively trying to get that message out more effectively. So, you know, certainly since, you know, I've been associated and been chairman of the association, I've seen the companies willing to pony up more dollars into the association.
Yeah.
But it's never going to be the magnitude that you can actually put in from the brand side, if you think about it. I mean, you know, some of the products on the brand side, just the single product will generate, you know, $5 to $10 billion of profits per year, right? You can look across the major companies, right? You look at a company, you know, Mylan was cited. I mean, their entire corporate profits were about $2.5 billion.
So, right? So if you're not, if you can't do it, if you can't, you know, buy ad time on the networks, who are your allies in telling the story, or what are your avenues for telling the story? And by the way, let's have this unfold so that I don't have to target a person for a question. Let's just have a chat about that.
Well, I think, you know, building on what Craig had already said, getting patients, you know, getting other parts of that healthcare process involved. To a certain extent, it's going to be payers at some point. If we're going to push transparency, and we start to show where the, you know, the real dollars lie, we need to take and get out there and get to the balance of the healthcare system, the healthcare supply chain, to be a part of that solution and tell the generic story.
I think, like Craig said earlier, we have to magnify our voice. You're never going to be able to compete dollar to dollar with big pharma, but we have to, you know, be smarter in how we spend our dollars and target the right stakeholders. I mean, so
go
to, you know, the HHS, to Treasury, and present what the industry does for healthcare spend. You know, I also think that part of it is the industry has gone through evolution over the last many years. I mean, so when you're just establishing yourself, you're really fighting the hurdles on, you know, quality. You know, when 10 years ago, generics were considered low quality and you know, cheap copies, and we've come a long way from there, you know, at this point. So I think we are at a point where we have the ability, both financially, as well as you know, with what the industry is investing into in complex areas like biologics and devices, to tell the story the right way.
My wife, who's a physician, and I'll make this the last time I refer to her, but she's also a former journalist before she went into medicine, and she still writes for the Washington Post. And 10 years ago, she wrote a piece in the Washington Post from the point of view of a physician, sort of revealing that her colleagues at that point, and only 10 years ago, were still resistant to prescribing generics, partly out of habit, partly, she suggested, out of incentives. But a very big part of it was that the patients were pressing for the things that they saw on television.
Right.
And they thought that they were being cheated otherwise. And I spoke with her about it, and she said there's been a revolution in that regard since that decade has gone by. So does that suggest that patients are, and I know already in the clips that we've seen, we're seeing patients talking, but does that suggest that you need to find a way to corral or to harness patient passion about this question?
Yes, we do. I mean, I think, and it's look, we're benefiting anybody who takes pharmaceuticals in the country. When we have 90% of the prescriptions, we have more than that of the doses, right, that are in the country. So you think about it, virtually anybody who's taking medicine in this country has taken a generic. And that's helped them because of the cost of the generic, whether they know that or not, because it's often buried in insurance and stuff. So it's actually building that awareness, and so they understand the opportunity. And I think the campaign that, as you've seen come forward here, actually is incorporating patients much more centrally into it. But I think that our success is going to think about how do we mobilize those allies against the things that we need to either succeed in or prevent from happening to succeed as an industry. We don't need help, really, on the penetration of our products when we already have 90% of the market in the U.S. But what's happening now is there are many, many things that are being portrayed as, you know, a zero-sum game out there, where it's not really a zero-sum game. You know, that we talked about the painting of our industry in the same brush as pharmaceutical, the brand pharmaceutical companies that actually have much bigger margins. And some of the solutions that are being put forward out there could actually make generics more expensive, because it will cause us to stop marketing some of our products because they will be significantly money-losing products. Right? If you think about the inability to raise price in generics, if you think about importation taxes when most of our products are made overseas, there's some logic to them from America, right, and thinking about making our country more competitive. But when you think about this industry, and I think this is a national asset, right? The fact that we have 90% penetration is huge for our country. Could actually result in fewer products on the market and higher prices. And that's a message that we need to get the people that are benefiting from our products to tell Congress,
yeah,
to tell the administration. Because I think there's a lot of collateral damage and the things that are potentially happening here that could really hurt our industry.
Well, Alok, when, you know, we all know that President Trump began making statements late December, early January about cracking down on drug prices. He was mostly talking about Big Pharma, but then he has a meeting with Big Pharma. And honestly, the fact that he's had a meeting with them, but not with you, does your heart sink in your sector? Does your heart sink at that moment that those guys are getting into the meeting?
You know, just a little bit, you know, because, you know, there's an upside to that too. So given the unpredictability, we were okay going second and, you know, just knowing where this would be. But, you know, on a more serious note, I think, you know, it is important for us to write from the White House to HHS and Treasury and the Hill, the Help Committee and so on, that we orient our messaging to each of those individuals in a way that's relevant, that's precise in how they think about us or how they ought to think about us, and also do the same thing with our influencers or, you know, patient advocacy groups that we haven't really been very active with, and how do we kind of leverage, you know, the group to make sure that our voice and message is clearly heard, because, you know, we not only, you know, the volume and that we deliver in terms of unit doses, you know, had it not been for, I think, the generic industry, Medicare Part D would probably have been bankrupt, you know. So we've been the backbone for Part D. We've, you know, saved just last year about $100 billion for between Medicaid and Medicare, mm-hmm. $225 billion for the overall healthcare systems in the U.S. So I think that story has to be told. Yeah. And pharma is obviously not telling that story for us.
Benita, looks like you were agreeing.
Oh yeah, I agree, and I don't think there's a benefit in going first here. Yeah, I think that after the first 100 days, you know, and once things have settled down, would be the right time to, you know, pitch our industry.
Well, let's role play that a little bit. I'll be Donald Trump. And this is the meeting. We're going to have a terrific meeting. It's going to be the best meeting that there's ever had. They're bringing in donuts. These are the best donuts that anybody's ever had.
Are you going to be tweeting?
Is that real hair?
Yeah. All right, that's where I draw the line at my comments on the president. But let's do that. And I'll be a silent Donald Trump. I'll just let you, as a group, make your pitch, whoever wants to go first. But that might be instructive for how to formulate this message and where you would take it. So whoever wants to jump in first, I'll be Mr. President. Don't be shy.
I'll jump in.
Okay.
So, well, President Trump, I understand that you are a big believer in the free market. And I understand that you also are a big advocate for lower healthcare costs. So I think you need to understand that this industry is the epitome of the free market. Right? The reason we have low generic prices in this country is because we have free market competition. We have the ability to raise and lower our prices, to compete for accounts. And any legislation that actually impedes that will have a major detriment to this industry and will also result in higher healthcare costs.
Do your friends talk at all?
I think he's making a fair point. You know, that is really the message that we're
talking. No, I'm still about. Mr. Trump.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, but I mean, the message that he's trying to portray is the full message. We want to take and open up access to medications, make them more cost affordable, and anything or any legislation that prevents that or interferes with that is going to have significant implications to our healthcare system. If you look at what's happening today, just the first couple of months of this year, employers are pushing the cost of healthcare more and more onto their employees. It is going to raise the level of noise as it relates to pharmaceutical pricing to our patients, mm-hmm. because they're now paying out of pocket until they meet their deductible. So recognize that as that comes about, we need to do a better job of getting our message out, whether it be through, you know, to the administration, but just in general. So I think recognizing the fact that, you know, the conversation that Craig is having with Mr. Trump is very, very accurate. anything they do to put a barrier in place as it relates to increasing generic utilization or putting the barriers in place that are going to take away some of the our cost opportunities is going to be a problem.
So, Mr. Trump,
yes.
President Trump, we are very hopeful. We look at some of your recent statements and goals very hopefully. I mean, you have been very vocal about the FDA and the need to get an expedited process to get products approved very efficiently, and we look forward to success on that front, you know, for us to really be able to serve the industry even better, to be able to bring more affordable medicines to the market sooner. I'd like to also give you our perspective on some of the tax reform measures that we have heard. You know, we've talked about border adjustability tax and import tariffs. A good part of generics in the U.S. are imported, and there needs to be an understanding if there is an import tax or a border tax, it's going to raise the cost of medicines coming into the U.S., and ultimately it's going to raise the cost for patients and the healthcare system.
Mr. President, thanks for finally having us as generic executives. So, you know, I really think the momentum that the generic industry has delivered to the U.S. healthcare system, savings of $150 to $200 billion over the last 7 years, where you saw generic utilization go from 50% in the U.S. to about 90% now, all in the space of 7 years. That is significant, and that is that momentum has to only be carried forward if you're going to solve the healthcare issue for the American people. I also think that, as my colleague was saying, bulk of the product is imported in from centers of excellence around the world where plants have been set aside for a unique dosage form, and those economies of scale have been built up over these last 10 years or so, and those ought to be leveraged as we bring high-quality medicine for the American people. So as you think about any kind of taxes or tariffs, the challenge with that would be is you'll have generic delays in the market. You will see product shortages. You will see products getting approval from the agency but not hitting the market, which is quite frankly tragic. So there will be unintended consequences of you know, a policy along those lines. Not saying that you're contemplating that, but based on what we hear, you know, that's something that
who knows?
Wanted to.
Yeah.
That, you know, that wasn't rehearsed. That was pretty good. I think that's a really good start for you guys. Yeah. I want to go back to a couple of the points, though. Benita, you were already getting to, you were both also, you were getting to this issue of this, the president's clear message of America First. He's making it clear that he wants to bring manufacturing jobs back. He hasn't, again, said exactly where, but obviously, for all of your firms, this would be a serious problem. You do manufacture overseas, and in a look, in a way, the very argument that you made that it can be done more efficiently overseas is the one that the president has been, and Bernie Sanders, for that matter, has been saying. So what? That's not what matters. Does this America First message concern you as much as I suspect that it does in terms of the business side of it?
Not, I mean, I would say not a whole lot. There is obviously, as you know, at a high level, you know, just creates a sense of urgency for folks like us to tell our story and to clarify, you know, some of the inputs that ought to go into a policy or you know, when they kind of table their views. So I think the market forces are, in this case, I think if you just look at the supply side and the demand side, mm-hmm. and what's needed for our country here, it's pretty obvious that you know, anything that is done to create either tariffs or blockages to generic entry, where I would say about half the product or more than that is actually manufactured outside, and you play that out that for most of the first line therapies, second line therapies, you will absolutely have an issue. And patients, you know, if you look at the patient population, the aging of the patients in the U.S. and most of the patients on chronic CV diabetes medicines, an average 70-year-old is on 12 medicines in the U.S. and 8 of those are manufactured overseas. You think about the disease that they have, which has lifelong risk, and if they stop their medicine for whatever reason, mm-hmm. then that is tragic.
Yeah, I think we want to have a discussion, obviously, with the administration, but any knee-jerk reaction, any impulsive decision to take and put a tax on pharmaceuticals coming into the U.S. would seriously hinder the supply chain. You know, when you look and talk to Vanita, you talk to Alec, you talk to Craig, they've built up their capabilities over the last 10 to 15 years for manufacturing, for R&D, to bring these products to the market and get approval. To make any kind of a quick decision, it's going to take us 5, 10, 15 years to bring those capabilities back to the U.S. If that
long?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. To absolutely be able to take and compete, sure. So any knee-jerk reaction that we would make, I think would have serious implications to our healthcare system here in the U.S.
And I think one also has to consider that it will set back the industry and set us back from achieving our goal of bringing affordable medicines to market. I mean, when you ask the question, do you get concerned about it, the America First and the fact that we bring majority of our products from overseas into the country? We made a major investment in the U.S. last year. We bought a facility in New Jersey, and we have a manufacturing in India. So we have the flexibility to manufacture both places. But we know what the cost of manufacturing is in the U.S. versus India. Mm-hmm. I mean, with our goal being to bring affordable medicines to market, we will not be able to bring drugs that currently sell at a dollar for 60-day supply out of a U.S. facility. So costs of drugs in the U.S. will definitely go up if you have tariffs on products coming into the country.
Mm-hmm. I think what gets lost in all of this is Teva by itself has 20,000 employees in the United States. It's not like we're doing all of our manufacturing and conducting all of our business.
That's true for all of you, isn't it?
Yeah, we have 20,000 employees in the U.S.
I want to move the topic a little bit forward to a question of biosimilars. And Craig, you have been quite recently at the forefront of trying to bring a product to market. Tell us your story.
Yeah, well, we have currently 7 biosimilars under development. But I think it's interesting to look at biosimilars. There's 4 approved in the U.S. so far. Only 2 are on the market, right? And I think the FDA has actually done a decent job in terms of beginning to build their capabilities and bringing in experts and advisory boards and looking at the products.
And that's not kicking and screaming. They're
well, there's certainly some things to work at. But the biggest issue that we're facing with biosimilars is not the FDA. It's actually legal issues, right? And I think there has got to be some way that we can actually break out of the challenges. And I'll use Humira as an example, right? We're in this country, right, where we don't have enough money for healthcare. That's what all the problems are. It's getting shifted to patients, and we have the highest percentage of GDP. I did an analysis. There's one Pacific island that has a higher percentage of GDP healthcare than the U.S. That's it. No other country in the world, right? So we pay more for healthcare, but then you start looking at some of the inefficiencies in it. Humira is an interesting example. It's a drug that itself is forecasted to be $16 to $17 billion in sales. Right? Its composition of matter expires this year. So we should have, there's a Humira drug approved. So you should expect to see competition coming into that marketplace. Over the last 3 years, AbbVie has, because they're making as much money as they're making, been able to put 110 patents in place. Now most of these patents, I mean, are they gonna stand or not, but they're guaranteeing years of litigation. You know, if you just hold competition off using those patents for 3 or 4 years, that's close to $60 billion that could come back into the US healthcare system to pay for innovation. And it's more that we're paying money going into litigation as opposed to innovation. And that's the problem. That's what's holding up the launches of these programs. And I actually fear, if there's not something done about this, that every biologic product from here on out is going to have the same thing happen. That they're going to say, hey, look what AbbVie did. And now I'm going to go figure everything I can possibly patent, tie up everybody in court. And that is, I think, the biggest threat.
Why is that different from generics 15 to 20 years ago?
Well, I think if you look at how typically the drug market worked, you had the Orange Book, you had patents that were filed, which does not exist in the 351k pathway. So you knew exactly the patents. You could make intelligent decisions as a company on what products you could actually challenge patents on, what you had to wait for expiration. In the 351k pathway, it's a totally different regime. We have to spend, and by the way, most of these products cost over $200 million to develop, develop the product, and then we turn our applications over to the brand companies so they can comb through it to see all the patents that they can dig up that we violate, and then we start litigation.
Well, take us a little bit, again, without giving away proprietary secrets, take us a little bit into the conversations held in your company about whether to go forward or give up. I mean, you what you've just described sounds like an intense molasses to walk through.
I think anybody in biosimilars would agree with that.
Yeah. So is there a go, no-go decision made
on
already?
Every product? Every product there is, right? And you look at every product in terms of what the patent situation is. You look at your ability to design around the patents that are available if you can, although many of these patents don't issue until you're all well into development. You look at how you can actually negotiate or navigate in different markets around the world. That's why we partner with Mylan on our program, so we could actually get access to markets that may not have this amount of a patent estate. But it is it's a very strategic issue for everybody in the biosimilars business. I think it's actually, when we get to market, going to be a reasonably attractive place to make profits. But the ability to delay is going to have to require different strategies.
Ultimately, well, what sorts of strategies?
Well, like I said, like designing around. Uh-huh. Ultimately, we may need to have a debate about how you litigate in this field. And if you look at the tech industry, which has seen, like iPhones, 150 different patents against them, the courts have taken more reasonable approaches to reasonable royalties as opposed to blocking competition. In pharmaceuticals, it's typically been the other side of that coin, where there's injunctions and we can't launch against patents, or the potential for treble damages at launching against them are so high we don't launch. Some kind of reform in that could actually help change things as well. So we're going to have that debate.
Well, to your question, we've debated it quite a bit in our organization, and we've invested into biosimilars over the last 8 years. We have 7 programs in various stages of development. We have our first major one, Enbrel, Etanercept, that is just completing phase 3 development.
What is it?
In a global trial. It's rheumatoid arthritis and psoriasis. We have debated it hard because there are a lot of uncertainties, and the development pathway is very onerous, very risky, and the commercial model is very opaque at this point. But when you think about it from a long-term perspective, and you think about it the next 5 years, the next 10 years, I mean, today, biologics are $90 billion, huge part of that drug spend, and it's the fastest growing segment of the market. Mm-hmm. I believe it's going to be a big part of the generic industry in the future. So it's not whether you are in it or not, it's how you navigate on the biosimilars front for us. You know, you choose the right programs, you find risk mitigated strategies to be able to get there eventually.
Alok, are you thinking the same way?
So yeah, absolutely. We've been in biosimilars now for 10 years, mostly in the emerging markets. And what we've seen is when you launch a biosimilar product at a fraction of the price, it has just tripled or quadrupled the market size. So a lot more patients overseas in the emerging markets, so be it in India, a Latin American country, or even in Russia, you know, you've seen expansion in the market. The challenge here is, as I think Craig put it very concisely, it's the IP issue is quite significant, and that has to be really looked at. There is this, you have to develop, give your dossier to the innovator, they go comb through that, then once it's approved, then you have to give a heads up, and that's the patent dance, and you know, the submarine patents and so on, which is, you know, which has to be cleaned up. And you know, separately, you know, even from a regulatory perspective, at a product level, you know, there has to be better guidance and early in development, kind of like what Europe has in place. So there, Europe's a step ahead of where we are. So there is a lot to be done on the IP side. There's a bit to be done from a regulatory perspective, and then of course we need to build some commercial muscle as well to really do justice to this, because all products would have, from a naming standpoint, you still need fundamental demand to be generated by the doc. You know, going back to what you were saying about what your wife said about generics 10 years ago, so you'll have the same phenomena, you know, front and center on biologics and biosimilars.
Can I add just one point on that? I just in terms of the overall conversation here, because you asked a question about, you know, if we're looking at the economics and how do we make those decisions. I just don't want to lose the mission aspect of what we as companies do, right? This is not an easy business, right? You have to have excellent management. You have to be able to survive on razor-thin margins across much of your portfolio. But there is a strong belief of bringing affordable medicines. And when we look at biosimilars, you know, that's a set of products where, and I am all for innovation. We have innovative products like most companies here do, but it's a set of products that for many of these products, it's $50, $100, $300,000 a year per patient to be able to get access to those. And that is required to pay for innovation. But it's our mission to make sure that when that patent is gone, when the composition patent is gone, that we're there to provide affordable alternatives. And that's why we're in the business, right? And we have to make a choice of how to strategically approach it. But don't lose that lens. I mean, we look at this as that is a huge contributor to both to expanding access to medicines, as well as actually getting affordable medicines in the countries that we serve.
So ultimately, it sounds like you need to influence legislation. I mean, that's where this has to go.
Yeah.
And again, like the marketing question, do you all have the muscle and the means to work that side of it?
I think it's an uphill battle. You know, you're talking about risk reward when you're talking about spending $200 million on a program. You could have done an awful lot of oral solids for $200 million. The risk reward is a very different model. Mm-hmm. And if we don't do something to allow the biosimilars to come to market in a more expeditious and in a more affordable manner from a development standpoint, I think Craig is right. You know, you're trying to lower the cost of healthcare, and if $90 billion is being spent on biologicals, it's going to be very difficult to break down that cost and bring our healthcare costs down if we don't find a path forward that takes away some of the barriers from a legal standpoint and other legislative standpoints.
But I think there's also an awareness at this point. I mean, earlier today, heard Dr. Woodcock speak, and she spoke about biosimilars and the fact that the agency is looking at simpler models, the weight of evidence, I think is the term, models to try to get biosimilars approved. And it'll take us some time. I mean, again, with biosimilars, we're going to have to address the hurdle from a patient perspective, physician perspective. So maybe in the near term is going to be this heavy investment model. But over time, we hope that they're going to be simpler PK/PD, less onerous development pathways for biosimilars.
It's interesting to me that normally the main complaint I hear from companies that are in innovative fields is the regulation is the problem, the regulator is the problem. And I do not hear you guys having much of a grudge against the FDA here.
You know, we're not saying that FDA doesn't have things to do, right? I think if you look at a $200 million cost to develop for a biologic, those costs are primarily based in clinical trials and in validation, right? And so somehow we have got to use enlightened regulation as well as technology to allow us to be able to reduce clinical trials, as was brought up here with PK/PD, and be able to reduce validation costs. To give you an example, right, I'll go back to a drug like Humira, right? If you're being asked to do large-scale validation of your final runs, right, possibly 4 or 5 years before you would launch, which means all that product is going to be thrown away, just that validation can cost $30 to $50 million. Wow. And it's wasted product, right? And so somehow we've got to find a more efficient way through the regulatory process and use of our own tools to be able to get these products to market. But we start with the legal side because we need a market, right? If there's no market, right, that's the bigger problem.
Yeah. But is it your sense, and I know an agency is made up of many individuals, but is it your sense that the ruling mindset or philosophy within the FDA is to try to make, you know, in the interests of the consumer and the customer and pricing being part of that, is it your sense that the FDA is more or less on your side in wanting to find a way to get biosimilars to market for you guys to succeed, basically?
So I think they're on our side, but there's two sides of it, right? They have a public health mission to actually get lower cost drugs out there. That's
right.
That's a view that they have. But they also are a regulator, right? And they're a regulator which puts them in a conservative position, right? Because if anything goes wrong, it's their fault, right? And so philosophically, they're with us. What the body of evidence that's required to get them to move is the unknown.
Where does your market growth come from now? When I hear you say in the beginning that you 89% of prescriptions in the United States are generic already, where do you go? I mean, after you get the other 11%, where do you go? Where's growth going to come
from? So I think the bulk of the growth is still in complex generics in the very short term. So the remaining kind of 75% value, you know, even if you get a fraction of that, that's a fair amount of growth. So, you're looking at the backlogged ANDAs. You heard the agency talk about that yesterday and today. So several thousand, so, you know, 5,000 to 7,000. Off those, you've got about 10 to 15%, which are first two files or somewhat complex. Now, if that's accelerated, plus the filing on an annual basis that each one of us are doing, if that's accelerated, that's, you know, gets you short-term growth. In the mid to long term, it's going to be biosimilars. You know, that's going to be, at least for those who have declared that as part of a strategy, it will be, you know, large molecules, biologics, that'll drive growth. So, that's what it's coming down to.
Yeah, I think growth will be dependent upon the organization that you're within. There's going to be different capabilities, different technologies. So I think depending on where you are, what you do to grow, and your diversification may be very different. It may be biosimilars. We know overall that the aging of the population is going to continue to grow the overall market over a period of time between now and especially 2050. But I think the capabilities that each of the organizations have and the ability to take and manage some of those complex products, whether they be biosimilars or just complex, long-acting, respiratory, those capabilities will determine, you know, what direction a company goes in.
Well, that 11% is $380+ billion worth of revenues. So it's a tremendous, opportunity from a growth perspective. Just in the next 5 years, it's again over $90 billion worth of products going off patent. The next 10 years is double that. So there's still a tremendous opportunity on the generic front. Yes, a good part of it is complex generics. A good part of it is biologics. So you have to navigate, the biologics vertical. But also, you know, a good part of it is other dosage forms, like Andy said, devices, inhalation products. So we as an organization have invested heavily into complex generics. We made a significant investment in trying to bring metered dose inhalers, dry powder inhaler generics to market, along with biosimilars. And then, you know, as a global company, you look at U.S., of course. U.S. is the largest part of our business, but we have significant growth drivers also other parts of the world.
Chip Davis said in his remarks yesterday that the industry needs to accept that its biggest customer is becoming the U.S. government. And in saying that, I got the sense that he was saying there's resistance to recognizing that. Am I reading that correctly? Is there some sense of not wanting to?
I think we all are already working very heavily with the U.S. government as a customer. I think where he was going was that could put very different economic pressures on us as an industry, starting to negotiate with government. I mean, if you look at our industry, right, there's two questions. One is growth, right, and we can talk about all of the opportunities of the 10%, but it won't be those values once we get a hold of it and start competing, right? And the other is, you know, profitability, and how do we actually retain profitability? And you heard the previous panel talking about potential overcapacity in the industry and prices, and you're hearing us talk about, you know, inadvertent legislation that could decimate profitability in part of our product lines. So how do you deal with a commoditized business? Because you can have many commoditized businesses that can be quite profitable. The way you do is you actually let the free market take care of it. I don't know if it's going to be mergers. I don't know if people are going to exit product lines. Ultimately, this would be a healthy business, and we know how to compete in it. If you constrain a commoditized business, you can destroy it. And I think that's the main message in the profitability side is, you know, what might be good or bad for an individual company, you know, that's life, we compete. But when you start, distorting competition and the business that has the margins that this one survives on, then the ability to be able to invest to go after that other 10% is going to be severely impeded. And I think that's my biggest concern as I look forward.
One of your one of the messages you put forward, I think you would even put forward in the meeting with President Trump, is that you believe in competition, that that's sort of your edge. That's part of what you do. You compete with each other. You compete with Big Pharma. But there's also this process of consolidation going on in the generic world as well. Does that argue against your claim to be all for competition?
I think that's part of the free market.
Yep.
I think that's exactly part of it.
Yeah, consolidation, if it's done the right way, and I think Ronnie and Randall were talking about it, if it's done the right way for the benefit of healthcare, then it's a good thing. You know, we have the ability to rationalize our R&D pipelines. Where we were, you know, before Teva and Actavis were working on the exact same products. Well, that frees up capacity for us to work on other opportunities to bring biosimilars, to bring other projects to market that we may not have been working on individually. There's also supply chain efficiency that comes along with that. And it's not just on the manufacturer side, it's on our customer side, it's elsewhere in the industry. If it's doing something to lower the cost of healthcare to provide more efficiency, I'm all for consolidation.
All right, well, I just want to say that as a civilian, I have found this conversation really fascinating and informative, and during the White House meeting, quite entertaining as well. And I hope that all of you experts have as well. Thank you very much to our panel for joining us.
Thank you.